Our world contains a lot of water, the vast majority residing in the oceans. We need fresh water to drink, cook, wash dishes, or irrigate. That is much more limiting. Freshwater resources of the world vary dramatically from place to place. Brazil enjoys an annual renewable freshwater supply of 8,200 cubic kilometers. This works out to about 9,700 million liters for every square kilometer, a bit less than half square mile. Of land surface, or 4,500 million liters per person. The much drier North African country of Morocco commands only 29 cubic kilometers of freshwater per year, about 65 million liters per square kilometer, and less than a million liters per person. In the United States and Canada, both the United States and Canada can access a bit over 3,000 cubic kilometers, or about 335 million liters per square kilometer. This is about 10 million liters per person for the United States, while Canada's much smaller population enjoys 100 million liters per person. These numbers sound like enormous quantities of water, but they are not. We share that water with industrial users and, yes, with nature. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video will discuss sources of fresh water, the need for water conservation, and water quality. So where do we get our water? It starts with the hydrologic, or water cycle. The hydrologic cycle is an engine fueled by the sun's energy that transports water from the ocean to land and back again. Air moistened by evaporation from the surface of the ocean passes over continents, where it is shifted upward by warm air rising from the landmass. When moist air has risen high enough, water vapor condenses into precipitation, rain, snow, and hail. Some rainwater runs into streams and lakes. Most of this water finds its way into rivers that finally flow into the ocean. Other water is absorbed into soil to later evaporate or be used by plants. Finally, some rainwater percolates into the water table, which is the upper surface of saturated underground material. Most of this, too, eventually returns to the sea. It is worth pointing out that climate change is rapidly accelerating this water cycle. Higher temperatures means more energy. With more energy, more water can be transported more quickly through the cycle. It also means an increase in amplitude in precipitation variation. That is, more extremes between wet and dry cycles, and more extreme events like 100-year rainstorms, exceptional snowfalls, or severe prolonged drought. Let us look more carefully at the point in the cycle when precipitation lands on the soil. Water proceeds in the cycle by one of four paths. Rainfall or snowmelt that cannot be absorbed into the soil fast enough runs into low areas, streams, or lakes. This water is called runoff. Gravitational water percolates through the root zone of plants. Some may enter the water table. Some of the remaining water stored in the soil evaporates from the surface back into the atmosphere. Most water taken up from soil by plants is transpired into the atmosphere. The total water loss due to transpiration and evaporation is called evapotranspiration. An average of 30 inches of precipitation falls each year over the continental United States, but the supply of water is unequally distributed. Average annual precipitation ranges from 9 inches in Nevada to 55 inches in Louisiana. Eastern states and the Pacific Northwest coastal areas tend to have higher rainfall, while most western states have a more arid climate and have to depend on irrigation to grow many crops. More important than simple annual precipitation is the balance of precipitation and evapotranspiration. In the eastern half of the country and parts of the west coast, more rain falls than is lost to evapotranspiration. In these humid climates, water does not usually limit crop production except on excessively well-drained soil or during occasional periods of dryness. In a semi-arid climate, evapotranspiration slightly exceeds precipitation and moisture limits production. Special dryland farming systems or irrigation overcome the problem, such as the use of grazing land. In arid climates, where evapotranspiration greatly exceeds precipitation, crop growth depends on irrigation. Despite the importance of irrigation nationally, natural rainfall remains the most important source of water. 75% of our food and fiber is grown in rain-fed fields. Climate change models predict significant changes in precipitation patterns that will influence agriculture. Rainfall in eastern states may increase. In fact, it has been mounting over the past decade or so. Rainfall in western states may decline. making a semi-arid and arid zone even drier. Furthermore, if temperatures rise in western states, evapotranspiration rates will follow, as will the length of the growing season during which evapotranspiration occurs. The total effect will be to increase the moisture deficit in these states. The remaining three sources of water, as shown in the top figure, comprise stored water society draws on: saline ocean water, fresh surface water, and groundwater. As the figure shows, saline ocean water supplies only a small percentage of the water used annually, and is very expensive both in cost and energy. Fresh surface water and groundwater are critical sources for irrigation and non-agricultural uses such as drinking water. Surface water occupies lakes, rivers, and ponds and covers approximately 60 million acres of American land. The water is distributed unequally. Most surface water is in the Great Lakes and a few other states, especially Alaska, Texas, Minnesota, Florida, and North Carolina. In many western states, surface water for irrigation and other uses depends on rivers fed by snowmelt in mountains. There, the annual mountain snowpack is a matter of great concern, especially in this changing climate. Groundwater is stored in underground formations called aquifers. There is far more groundwater than surface water. Experts estimate that some 8,000 trillion to 10,000 trillion gallons of water are contained in mainland United States aquifers. However, this water renews very slowly, averaging about 3 inches per year. According to the United States Department of Agriculture, USDA, about 25% of the nation's groundwater supplies are being mined, withdrawn more rapidly than renewed. This occurs mostly in the southern plains and the southwest, where the water loss per day in an average year is 15 billion gallons of groundwater. Agriculture consumes almost 70% of the water used annually in this country, mostly for irrigation. With expanding competition for water with growing urban populations and calls for increased stream flows to maintain natural habitats, the percentage of water dedicated to agriculture is likely to decline. Schemes to persuade growers to sell irrigation water to expanding municipalities has already begun to be implemented in western states. Even worldwide, water use is reaching some limit. Between 1940 and 1990, worldwide withdrawal of fresh water for human use quadrupled, mostly going to irrigation. This rapid expansion of irrigation was one of the factors responsible for a significant reduction in hunger in some parts of the world. Unfortunately, the supply of fresh water is limiting by dynamics of the water cycle. Interestingly, total water usage in the United States, according to the U.S. Geological Survey, peaked in 1980, including for irrigation. Public supply, water provided to people for non-industrial use, has continued to grow, but less rapidly than population growth. The nation and its growers benefit from agricultural conservation efforts in three ways: preservation of water resources, increased yields, and fewer water quality problems from runoff. It takes 40 gallons of water to produce one egg, 150 gallons to produce one loaf of bread, and 2,500 gallons for 1 pound of beef. If forecasts are correct, growers will increasingly compete with other users for the nation's water to produce such agricultural products. As the largest user, agriculture has a special responsibility to conserve, both for national well-being and its own self-interest. Water conservation methods result in improved soil moisture and better yields. Semi-arid areas respond especially well to conservation efforts. For example, about 4 inches of water is needed to mature a wheat crop. Reports from USDA research indicate that each additional inch of available moisture stored in the soil can raise production from 2.5 to 6 bushels per acre. Some of the strategies for conserving water involve reducing runoff from farm fields. Methods for reducing runoff do more than improve soil moisture. They have other beneficial effects, such as reduced erosion and topsoil loss, reduced downstream flooding because less water runs into rivers, and reduced water pollution from soil particles, fertilizers, pesticides, and human pathogens carried off farm fields by runoff. Water quality is as important as water quantity. Like conserving water, agriculture has a special role in the preservation of our nation's water supplies. Fish kills in trout streams caused by runoff from insecticide-treated cornfields are an example. Agricultural sources of water pollution are difficult to pin down, compared to a pipe coming out of a factory or sewage plant. Such point sources of pollution are relatively easy to identify, and government regulations have allowed the nation to make good progress in bringing industrial and urban point sources under control. Most agriculture is a non-point source, such as farm fields. An exception is large manure storage facilities and feedlots, which can be identified and are considered point sources. A number of studies have indicated that agriculture now accounts for the bulk of water quality problems across the nation. Current agricultural issues include seepage of nutrients such as nitrates and pesticides into groundwater, and pollution of surface waters. Contaminants of the latter include soil particles, pesticides and fertilizers, organic debris, and disease-causing organisms. Manure applications can discharge nutrients into both groundwater and surface water and can be a source of human pathogens. It has been assumed that the soil matrix filters chemicals from percolating water. Too often, the assumption has turned out to be false. Preferential flow can bypass the soil matrix and move pollutants deeper into the soil quickly. While agriculture leads all the contributors to water pollution, urban areas contribute lesser amounts. Most storm drains conduct contaminated runoff into rivers or other receiving bodies of water. For that reason, Florida bans most uses of phosphorus in lawn fertilizers. The storm sewer systems in many cities are already undersized for the more frequent heavy rainfalls, causing bursts of polluted water to enter surface waters. Many of these cities are working on green solutions like rain gardens to avoid expensive upgrades of stormwater and sewage systems. Ways to avoid water pollution are largely covered in various sections of this video series. Here's a brief summary. Reduce runoff that can carry contaminants. Reduce erosion that can carry contaminated soil. Reduce fertilizer losses in percolating water. Apply and store manures properly. Retain and restore wetlands that can filter pollutants from runoff. Practice drainage management in artificially drained fields. Install conservation buffers along streams and other bodies of water to slow and filter runoff. And follow LEED standards in construction of new buildings. In conclusion, water conservation is important because usable fresh water is not an unlimited resource. Each grower has an interest in conserving water as well. Making the best use of water increases yields and controls erosion. Growers and other soil users need to pay attention to their contributions to polluted water. Fertilizers, pesticides, eroded soil, and organic debris can harm the environment and health.